During my walk, a lot of thoughts hit me up and I decided to record them and create really a video about sharing kind of where we are, what the problems is that I see, and sort of what are some of the thoughts and ideas and solutions that all of us have when it comes to solving this global crisis. It's a health crisis, but it's also a financial crisis, which I think is even bigger than the health crisis that everybody is talking about. So what I decided is I was have like almost an hour worth of thoughts and ideas that I have been trying to explain, all in the hopes to get you to start thinking differently, to start opening up your mind and really give you what it is that I am seeing from my point of view. I decided that having an hour video, I noticed that when I do a longer form videos that a lot of people don't really watch it because it's just a lot. So I decided to split this in three different parts. So right now you're going to see problem number one, where it's mostly basically intro and laying out the foundation of the problems that I am seeing as they have developed up until this point. And the date of recording this, we are at end of April. It's actually April 26th of 2020. So I want to give you kind of where we are right now, and that's going to be in the first part of the video. Thanks for watching. Enjoy. Make sure you subscribe. Hit that bell button if you want to get notified, and just you know, keep sharing this with folks, because that's what's going to help many more people and give us a bigger reach so that we can have a greater impact. That is the best thing we can all do right now, and it takes only a few seconds and it's free, so why not do it? Hey folks, Nev here of One Deal Away, and just going for a bit of a walk. It's a cooler day, but it's quite lovely and invigorating, and it's not raining yet, so I figure might as well go outside, get my body in a moving motion, and you know, before it starts raining and downpour. And then I'm basically going back inside. Got a few minor projects to complete on the inside when it comes to improving the property, and then it's on to working, creating some videos, doing some maybe even live stuff. I've been thinking about doing some live things on YouTube, maybe Facebook, but Facebook keeps crashing on me when I try to do live stuff. So we'll see if I'm going to be successful in doing things. And then of course, I wanna be able to look at the Socialize website. The build has actually been going really, really well. So the desktop version is completed, and the mobile version is 99% done, which is really amazing. So there are a few tweaks that I have to go through and put in writing to the developers so that they can help me out to bring this stuff. And as soon as we have that, I'm gonna be sharing it with you so you can hopefully give me some feedback of what you think works, what doesn't work, and how to make it better. You know, the overall goal is to give more access to more people of how to find some amazing deals that, you know, are already out there, but that are going to simply explode in the upcoming months and years. I do expect this particular market to be out of this world, and to be able to actually find some absolutely stunning and amazing deals. You know, I do expect real estate to drop down quite a bit, and you know, and that's even the market prices. So right now, if you are considering buying something at the freaking marketplace, please don't do it. I mean, obviously you can do whatever you want. I'm just giving you my feedback. I refuse to do it. I refuse to pay the full price or to bid the price up, because it just simply doesn't make sense. So if you are a seller, you might want to try to sell something rather quickly, or plan on holding it for a while. And when I say a while, I'm saying years. So I want to share with you kind of what I am seeing in the market and what are some of the things that definitely make me worried. I'm going to be doing some additional stuff with charts and graphs, explaining things. And, you know, maybe we'll do this thing live, whether I'm going to be streaming live to YouTube
or doing a Zoom call thing so that we can hang out yet again. I don't quite know yet. What I do know is that I wanna share these things out, and you know, if you can help me out by spreading the news, spreading the message, helping me reach out more people so we can, as a community, raise the awareness and help people out, that would be amazing. And you know, for some of the folks, they're thinking of like, well, if I share news with other people, they're gonna know the same stuff that I do, and then how am I going to benefit? That is a poor way of thinking. That's just my personal opinion, because abundance is something that is absolutely amazing. And you know, if we don't preserve wealth by of more people, then the divide is going to be greater, and what I fear is going to happen are going to be revolutions and famine and wars. And you know what, y'all, I don't want to see any of that stuff. I'd rather watch it on a TV or read about it in a history book, but I don't want to live through it again. I've gone through revolutions, I've lived through wars, I've lived through famine and lack of everything you can possibly think of. I don't recommend it at all. You don't want to try that. You know, there are certain things I'm always for, trying just about everything in life at least twice. And the reason I say twice is because the first time might have been a really bad experience. The second time you might find to enjoy it. But there are certain things that I know are bad for me. I don't want to experience it. Like breaking a bone, although I've actually experienced it, it's excruciating and painful, and I don't want to experience it ever again. So thank you very much. The beatings, the wars, starving, those kinds of things, I don't want to experience that ever again. And unfortunately, I wish I could tell you I've never experienced those, but that would be a lie, because I have. And I really don't recommend it at all to anybody, because times are really, really hard. And when you get stressed and you're trying to just survive, ability to think creatively and dream up a beautiful world and, you know, really thrive simply goes away. So I don't want that for you. I don't want that for me. I don't want that for anybody in the world. Like some of the things like that, I wouldn't wish on my biggest enemy, which I'm trying to think. I don't even know that I have. So just things to think through. So let's talk about some of the stuff that I am seeing and why I am incredibly worried about stuff, borderline petrified. Aside from not knowing exactly how things are going to play out, I can look a few months ahead based off of information that we do have, and with the probabilities of kind of thinking through what will happen, I think that the scenario that I will be describing to you probably has a probability of, I'm gonna say it, 60 to 70%. So I could be wrong, and I hope I am wrong, which sounds really horrible, because who the heck wants to predict something and then be wrong? But that's where we are. What is it that I have been seeing in the marketplace that is really making me pause and have grave concerns? So let's start with the really big picture thing. The 2020s were always going to be rather a tumultuous period of time because of the 75 plus minus million boomers that are, whose average age is, I want to say, about 65, that are going to be retiring. And not everybody is going to retire, I get that. But if they are involved in some sort of pension, IRA, 401k, 403b, blah, 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 they will have to legally, unless the laws change, they will legally have to start withdrawing some of the funds from there. Now, when you have, and so that's something to kind of keep in mind. The second piece to keep in mind is that vast majority of people that are invested in the markets today are boomers. There's some Gen X, my generation, hey guys. But you know, we're a small generation. There's not a whole lot of us. And so we get eaten by the boomers on one end, the millennials on the other end. The millennials are dealing with some of the problems of their own that has been created predominantly by what's been really helping boomers boom, and that is the ease of credit. The education piece has been pushed up, so vast majority of millennials cannot afford to participate in the markets for a few reasons. One, their income is not all that high, and I know some of them do have a really high income, but vast majority of them don't. They are also saddled with a lot of debt, which means they have to focus on paying that puppy as opposed to spending money on anything, and they're trying to figure out a place to live. So whether they're renting or buying, it doesn't really matter, because what is going on is that that stuff costs quite a bit of money. Even if they are renting, you know, the rental prices all over the world have been out of this world. And you know, and then the real estate prices are really high, especially if you are buying the traditional way of, you know, finding something through MLS or through the agent and kind of going, and a lot of them have been bidding up the prices. So that's the problem with the millennials, right? And so that's the generation that, you know, is the next biggest thing from the boomers. So vast majority of the people in the markets, and when I say markets, I'm mostly talking about paper assets, so stocks and bonds, have been boomers. And there's not a whole lot of boomers in the bonds, because bonds haven't been given as much of a return. So many of them and many pension funds are heavily, heavily, heavily invested in stocks, heavily invested in derivatives, and a lot of the stuff is being robo traded. So the algorithms runs based off of the news, based off of the other algorithms. So it's all robots basically taking control of our lives. So when you have more sellers than buyers, simple demand supply piece lets us know that the prices have to go down. As the prices go down, the robo traders will read that and they will start selling. So that's pretty much what was always going to happen. The coronavirus came in and sped everything up, and I'm sure you've heard that before, so I'm not giving you any new information here, but it's absolutely true, because you know, never in the history that I know of or could find or anything recorded has the entire world shut down. And you know what, who knows, maybe it has happened, but we were not as connected, and so it is possible that you had multiple countries closed up over the course of a period of time. But there are also the chance of all of that happening is slim to none, but we never knew because we weren't as connected, so you couldn't as easily find news about what was going on, you know, half a globe around, or you know. So that's kind of where things are right now. We have just about every country is closed up, shut down. The economic productivity is not happening. And the money that is being created is all debt. Fiat money is debt, always has been, always will be. The money that has been created, that sort of goosed up, so to say, the markets, is all debt created. It's all been printed, and the governments are trying to boost the stock markets around the world in the hopes that the wealth effect will be felt. But vast majority of people are not feeling it, and they have to do it for a few reasons. You got to keep the scheme going as long as you can and not let people catch on. The second reason is that, as I have mentioned, vast majority of investors in the markets are the boomers, and that also happens to be the largest voting base. So we are in 2020, which means it's an election year, and so letting things crash for the largest population that is actually filled with voters, that is also heavily invested in these markets, if you let that fall, you are asking for a lot of trouble. So you don't want to do that. You want to keep on boosting this stuff up. This, many people have referred to what is going on here today with 1929, but much faster because we are much more heavily leveraged and we're utilizing some technologies that could be really nice and beneficial, but that also add additional pieces of risk that we've never experienced before. So now you have a large base of boomers that hold wealth and are hoping that they can live off of it. You have millennials that are stuck with a lot of debt and cannot buy anything. They're just trying to survive. And then you have the Xers who, vast majority of us, it's a small population, but some of us have some holdings in the market. Vast majority of us are still trying to actually get into better jobs and climb those corporate ladders. You know, vast majority of us also have kids that are teens, meaning they're about to go into college or are in college. And so now you have to finance all of that stuff, which is a lot of money. And, you know, when you have kids, I mean, kids are not cheap to have these days. They're beautiful. They're amazing. There's a lot of, you know, internal sort of feel good about having kiddos. But they're not productive members of the society from the economic standing, they are just a large expense. And you know, if you have kids and you know, just feeding and diapers and clothes and all of those things cost a lot of money, and now you have to send them over to education, and you know, average cost of education has gone severely up over the last, I don't know, a few decades, to say the least. So that's kind of where the challenge rises for my generation of like, you can't invest. And then we have Gen Z, which are the little ones. And so they are still not, vast majority of them are not as productive members of society. They will be someday in a relatively speaking near future, but they're not helping right now in 2020, and they won't help for the next few years. So that's where we find ourselves. That's problem number one. Problem number two is the coronavirus, as like I've said, the world has shut down, which means productivity is down the drains, and the money that is being printed is basically trying to fill this giant gap hole that, you know, just keeps eating it, and it keeps eating at it. And so the hole is so deep that the amounts of money that they have printed, while huge, is a drop in a bucket comparatively to what is being lost. So what is being lost is, we are roughly talking about, this is a very, very rough estimate here, but you know, I'm estimating that we have dropped about 20, maybe $25 trillion in productivity. And I'm gonna let that sink in, $20 to $25 trillion. Now, the last few stimuli that have been developed, which is 1, 2, 3, and 3.5. Should be 4, but they're calling it 3.5 because I guess that 0.5 goes back to the original one that just wasn't enough and ran out of money in only a few short weeks. So the 3.5 stimuli that has happened is not even stimulus, because it is, right? Because it was printed and kind of being put in. But vast majority of the economists will argue that the stimulus has to be above and beyond of what is, you know, being created. So if creation is 1 trillion, stimulus would be anything above 1 trillion. When the loss is 1 trillion and you print 1 trillion, that's just covering the hole. So if our hole is about 20 to 25 trillion deep, and you know, we've only printed about 6, maybe 7 trillion by this point, maybe a little bit more, that's a, like I said, drop in a bucket. It's only a portion of what is being created, and the longer things stay at the standstill, the more of the stimulus will need to be created, more money will need to be created. And so that's kind of where the problem comes in, that the while the printing was big, it was nothing comparing to the loss. So that's what brings us here. So that's the big component that is happening. There have been some individuals out on different channels, some mainstream, some not so mainstream, And they have been estimating, 20 to 30% loss in productivity. I'm going to go on a limb and say that that's much higher. They are underestimating what's going on, just like they underestimated what the number of unemployment is going to be. And unemployment is a huge problem that we have today. We're talking roughly 26 million people, plus minus. And it's going to continue because what we've seen is frontline workers first, or the blue collar folks. The next wave, which I believe is coming, is going to be from the blue collar workers, many of which have been working from home. But now that the business no longer generates any income, holding on to those employees actually doesn't make sense because now they're costing money and there's no money coming in. So you're going to have to cut the expenses, which means many of those people will be furloughed and laid off. That is going to be a second wave, which is going to be just as big, if not even bigger. So that adds on to our giant problem.